Hi, everybody. I'm Mercy.
And I'm Crandall.
And we're going to take a look at the newest Harry Potter film, Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows, Part 1, because the book was so big,
yep,
they had to split it into two movies.
They did.
Even though the last book was so big, it should have been split into two movies, they crammed that into one.
Basically, and I don't disagree with that, I do think that Half-Blood Prince was probably the least satisfying movie because they cut out so much.
Yeah. I haven't read the books.
Yeah.
You have.
I have.
But I hear that a lot, that they try to cram in too much into the Half-Blood Prince, so they decided to just take the last book and rather than cramming it in and making it feel rushed, split it into two movies.
Mm-hmm.
Some people think it works great and some people not so much.
Right. So I'm one of the ones who thinks it works great. Now, basically, being a fan of the books, I really appreciated that this movie took the time to give us the small scenes that really pay off emotionally down the road.
Nobody else is going to die. Not for me. You may be the chosen one, mate. But this is a whole lot bigger than that. It's always been bigger than that. Come with me.
I'll leave Hermione.
You're mad. We wouldn't last 2 days without her. Don't tell her I said that.
And we got to revisit a lot of characters that if they tried to cram this whole story into 2.5 hours, would have fallen by the wayside. Mm. Now, as an adaptation, I think it is easily the best one because they didn't have to make as many changes, which really hurt, especially the last movie, where the title didn't even make sense because there was no significance to the Half-Blood Prince because they cut that entire plot out. But this one, we get all these quiet character moments that really raise the stakes, I think, because we see how much of an emotional toll all these events have taken on the main characters and their families and their friends.
Don't know why I listen to that radio every night, dear. To make sure I don't hear Ginny's name. Or Fred. Or George. Or Mark.
What, you think I'm not listening to? You think I don't know how this feels?
No, you don't know how it feels! Your parents are dead! You have no family!
Stop! Stop!
Finally, go! Go then!
Harry Potter, Hermione, and Ron Weasley have grown into incredible actors.
They really got lucky.
They are extremely lucky. The makers of these films are very lucky that these three actors are so dedicated to their roles. You can tell that these kids are taking acting lessons when they're not shooting. Mm-hmm. The most improved, I think, is Hermione.
Yeah.
I think a few of them along the way, she was bad. She was just
early
trying.
On. She was not good at all.
She was just like as a little girl, cute little girl. I mean, it's a totally different performance when from a child to an adult.
Yeah.
Child is, I think, what works the best is being over the top, mm-hmm. having full of energy and being energetic and loud and boisterous. A lot of the time what happens is as child actors age, they try too hard. It just looks like they're trying so hard. And Hermione was guilty of that in the earlier movies, just always with the sad face and the serious face. But she really pulls back, holds back in this one. Subtlety. It's all about subtlety.
Mm-hmm.
Harry Potter really surprised me, too. That actor is really, really good, too.
Daniel Radcliffe has gotten very good as the movies have gone on. And I've read that, you know, he watches each movie and learns from his mistakes and says, oh, man, I really should have fixed that. And it does show. Every movie, he has been getting better. And Harry's been getting more complex, mm-hmm. which really allows him to show that. And the performance has been very good.
Yeah, and then the biggest surprise, I think the best of the three, is the guy who plays Ron Weasley.
Yeah.
He's got some moments in there where he's walking behind and he's got the bags under his eyes and he's just brewing and stewing as he's thinking that Harry and Hermione have something going on between them because Ron Weasley and Hermione are an item. His subtlety, like he just says everything with his eyes. He's really grown into a fantastic dramatic actor, the best of the three, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he is very good.
So they're very lucky that those three actors got so good. The thing is, though, I've got an analogy about this movie as a whole.
Okay.
It's true that they needed more time. Like, you need more time. You can't rush scenes like that to make people care about these characters, to emotionally invest in them. I don't know if I haven't read the book, but I don't know if this thick book that's this thick should have been two movies that are 2.5 hours long.
Mm-hmm.
I think maybe it should have been a 3.5 hour movie. The Lord of the Rings formula, I think, is the best thing to follow. You got this thick Lord of the Rings book. They release a 3 hour movie, and then a year later, they release a 3.5 hour extended cut.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, the 3.5 hour Lord of the Rings movies they're fantastic.
Yeah.
Perfect length, pacing, everything. This one, I felt, even though I appreciate those quieter character moments, I felt it dragged sometimes, and it felt like the Lord of the Rings, the Two Towers, without the battle at Helm's Deep. That's what it felt like to me. It felt like The Empire Strikes Back,
mm-hmm,
without the Luke Vader duel at the end. It was all great, and then that's it.
But that's because you do have to appreciate that it is one movie being split into two.
Right.
Right. So it's not like they're calling the next one, you know, Harry Potter and the resolution of this stuff. It's part two. It's like, okay, we stopped halfway through. You're getting half now, half later.
It's a tricky thing.
So you're going to have to view it as 1 5-hour movie down the road.
Yeah. It's a tricky thing though, to do that to your audience, because when Empire Strikes Back came out, that was obviously not the final one in the saga. Like, audiences were told right in the opening credits, this is episode 5, and they knew there was going to be an episode 6,
mm-hmm,
afterwards. So even though they couldn't end the whole saga, they let you go home feeling like you got, you know, some sort of resolution. Like, there was a Luke Vader battle. There was, you know, it's a bit of a downer ending, but it's still an ending, that glorious shot of the space and everything. And then to go to the Lord of the Rings too, it's not the end of the saga, but it's like, wow, that was an amazing battle.
Uh-huh.
This Harry Potter film, though, there's a little skirmish at the end there.
Right, and that's mostly the source material, though, because there is no big battles in the middle.
Yeah.
That all comes later.
Yeah.
So, like, they ended it on that really down emotional note. I thought that was just the best way to end this movie, because Harry and everyone are in such a bad place, and things are so bleak, and we see, you know, the final shot of the movie is just one of those, oh my God, moments. Like, stuff is going to go down in this next movie that is going to be crazy.
Yeah. See, that's where I differ, because I think you can end on a downer, but you got to give them something. And Empire Strikes Back. But
we have
that
before, like when they go to the ministry, that whole sequence is fantastic. We get laughs, we get action, Harry running away from, you know, the...
But the movie does end on a total downer, right? Yep. I think the filmmakers should have tweaked the story a little bit to make it work. If they're going to take a book that was meant to be one book, and mm-hmm, they're going to split it into two movies, the book wasn't meant to be two movies, they should have done a little tweaking, because Peter Jackson did a whole bunch of tweaking to the Lord of the Rings movies. Like, a lot of stuff happens out of sequence in those movies. Something happens in the third one that actually happened in the second one.
Mm-hmm.
He rearranged a few things to make the audience leave the theater going, ah, you know, I feel like I watched an entire movie.
Azkaban, maybe. You could argue that Azkaban is the better movie than this. But anything else? I don't know. This one, hands down.
I'd say, yeah, I'd agree that this is the best one so far. Just, it's so good.
We're going to agree to disagree.
It's so good. It's one of those things where if they just tweak this a bit, it could have been perfect.
Agree to disagree.
Yes. Time for best part.
Worst part. Best part.
Best part.
Best part.
Best part.
Would have to be the cast.
I got to go with the tank sequence.
The special effects.
The final 10 minutes of the movie.
Man in suit.
Man in suit. So that's the best part.
Worst part.
Worst part.
Worst part.
Worst part.
Love story with Jessica Biel.
Cheap sounding canned.
Michelle Rodriguez.
Jennifer Aniston.
The entire movie.
Best part, I got to go with the three main characters. Their acting talent is fantastic, especially, like I said, Ron Weasley.
Mm-hmm.
Really, really fun watching him mature and grow into a great actor. Worst part, you know, I've gotten into it. The ending, I thought they could have just, if even come up with something completely new, that wasn't in the book, and then deal with the wrath of the fans of the book.
Yeah.
Because guess what, people? It's happened before. Changes have been made to books, and they've worked, because books are books, movies are movies, and everything that happens in the book isn't necessarily going to work for the movie.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, apparently they wanted to stay completely true to the books. I think it's okay to change the book sometimes. especially in a situation like this.
Well, and I'm never one who argues against changing the books, because I think most of the changes made in the series so far have been for the benefit of movie is a movie, book is a book. But if you're going to go the route of making two movies, you might as well adhere to it. And I respected the fact they didn't need to have some sort of big, huge climax to get us through, because that's not in the book. So they're just saying, you know, this is where the story goes, and we're just going to go with it. I will say the worst part is that we have to wait 8 months for the resolution of this movie, which goes to your point of, you know, they end it and it feels like half a movie.
See, thank you very much.
That is the worst part. But the best part is that the entire movie is so well directed. It is easily the best Potter. The music is fantastic. You know, the direction I thought was fantastic.
And it's directed by
David Yates, who did the last two. And I wasn't impressed with him at first. I thought his style was a little cold and detached. The emotional moments in the other movies weren't as emotional as they should have been. But this movie is supposed to be cold and detached because of where everyone is.
Mm-hmm.
So that worked perfect for it. The effects have been getting better. In the early ones, it was kind of low rent effects, and I think they've been getting better. And overall, I love where it ends. I think that the final shot is one of those iconic moments and just all kinds of cool.
Mm-hmm. And another big bonus that I didn't mention before is that there are a lot of familiar faces who pop up in this thing.
Basically, if you're a British actor of note, you're in this movie.
But not just actors, but Harry Potter characters.
Yep.
Like a lot of the previous characters show up. The downside of that is that they show up for a minute.
Mm-hmm.
So if you saw them in the trailer, that's pretty much what you're going to see of them in the movie. Right?
It's sort of the greatest hits of the characters popping in, doing their one song and getting out.
Yeah, so it's mostly the main three. Don't expect a lot of scenes with Lupin or Mad-Eye or anybody else, or even or even flashbacks with Dumbledore.
Right. We'll get some more of that kind of action in the next movie, I believe.
Mm-hmm. So Harry Potter, it's really cool to see it grow up over the years. It's really gone from a kid's thing to an adult thing over the years.
Mm-hmm.
Really cool to see it mature. And that last one, I think, is going to be off the chain.
Absolutely. So until next time.
Thanks for watching and enjoy the show.
Since I first met your face, yeah. Well, I'm talking about people getting inside your mind. And where did I feel this way? Say goodbye to